Just a second. Okay. Now it's working.
Yes. Yes.
So, given two smooth manifolds, we can ask whether M is embeddable in N. So, is M embeddable in N? And if it is embeddable, what is the set of isotopic classes? So, if yes, what is the set of isotopic classes? Right. So essentially, isotopic classes are all possible ways to not M inside N. And one can actually consider more kind of complicated question is, what is the homotopy type of the space of embeddings? So what is the homotopy type of the space of embeddings? Why I have this stuff? Let me erase everything. Clear canvas. Yeah, somehow I forgot to clear canvas. Right, so manifold functor calculus. Manifold functor calculus. Yes, and really we want to look at the space of embeddings. So space of embeddings of manifold M inside N. And like two previous questions are whether this set, this space is empty, or what are the set of connected components in this space. And finally, we can look at the just the homotopy space of this homotopy type of the space. So homotopy type of the space. Homotopy type of this space. So. And and the goal is really to develop some homotopy theoretical techniques to study embedding spaces. So develop. So we really want to develop homotopy theoretical techniques to study embedding spaces. This is really done by this manifold functor calculus. So this is the main motivation of this manifold functor calculus. And so just to explain what is this manifold functor is about, so consider manifold M, so smooth manifold. And we define the category of open subsets in M. Category of all open subsets. Sets of the manifold M. And we consider different functors from the O of M to topological spaces. Right, and actually we consider both covariant and contravariant functors. So this can be either covariant or contravariant. So in the covariant case, so the manifold functor calculus, so given such functor F, produces a series of approximations. So it's called the Taylor Tower of approximations. And the collimate of this tower is denoted by T infinity of F, and they all have map to F. So they all approximate F, including the collimate T infinity of F. So TK of F is the best, so the best degree K approximation of F. And so this sequence actually is called the Taylor Tower. So Taylor Tower. Taylor Tower. So in the contravariant case, we are going to have a very similar picture, with the only difference that all the arrows are going to look in the opposite direction. So in contravariant case, variant case, so we just have all the arrows reversed. So we get functor f, and then we have a tower of approximations. And we have maps which go this way. So what we mean by the best? So what really understood by this term, the best? So it means that when we have, like when we consider this map from tk of f to f, right? And when we choose any other polynomial functor p to f. So and again, this is an example in covariant case. Covariant case. So in the contravariant case, the errors are going to look in the other direction. So any other degree k functor. So any other degree k functor. And so it's a functor from p from O of M to topological spaces. Right, and by arrows I mean a natural transformation. So once we have this map, then there exists unique way to just a second. So no, actually, this arrow goes in this way. So once we have another arrow like this, then necessarily we are going to have factorization which goes this way. So just a second. So when we have right, so now the arrow should go this way. So the arrow, so there exists essentially unique arrow which goes this way. So that's what it means to be polynomial. And existence and uniqueness really is understood in homotopy invariant way. So we consider the category, model category of functors from O of M to top, and weak equivalences in this category are object-wise weak equivalences. So before giving formal definition of a polynomial functor, let me give you some examples. So examples of polynomial functors so that you can see why indeed they are called polynomial. So let me start with the linear functors. So what will be example of linear functors? Linear covariant functors. So we can assign to any open set in M, we can assign just the same space U, right? So it's a functor from U of M to topological spaces, right? So any open subset is topological space, and so this functor is going to be linear. So this is an example of linear functor. So another example would be a functor which assigns to any open set U, A times U, right? So it's really like linear function f of x equal to ax, right? So that's another example of a linear functor. So a little bit more complicated example, consider a fiber bundle. So let P be a fiber bundle over M with fiber F. And we assign to any open set U, we assign the preimage of U. Right, so we can also think about this as a twisted, like as a linear function with twisted coefficients. Right, so it's going to be a fiber bundle over U with fiber F. So these are examples of a covariant functors, and let me give you some examples of contravariant functors. So linear contravariant functors. So is it this example clear? That's kind of fun to see. So, is it clear, this example? Is it good? Okay, yeah. Good. Okay, so let me, yeah, so linear contravariant factors. So linear contravariant factors would be the following. So we can consider the factor which assigns to open set U the space of maps, continuous maps from U to any given space A. So this will be one example. So another example would be if we consider as before the fiber bundle over M. So we can define the factor which assigns to U the space of continuous sections of this fiber bundle over U. So notice that so the second factor is a generalization of the first one, right? So if we consider a trivial fiber bundle with fiber A over M, so then the space of sections is going to be exactly the mapping space of U to A. So, and this is kind of twisted example. So twisted generalization of the mapping space factor. So very important linear factor is a factor which assigns to U the space of immersions from U to a fixed smooth manifold N. And this is really a theorem by Smale and Hirsch. So Smale Hirsch theorem, which says that the space of immersions is equivalent. So, and actually here we assume the dimension of N is greater than dimension of M. So the space of immersions is equivalent to the space of formal immersions. So what is a formal immersion? So a formal immersion is a monomorphism of tangent bundles. So formal immersions consist of a monomorphism of tangent bundles, so which means that we need to have a continuous map between M and N, so F continuous map, any continuous map. And F is a monomorphism of tangent bundles which leaves F. So monomorphism of tangent bundles that lift F. So lifting F. So essentially this means that this square must commute. So notice that the space of formal immersions is equivalent to the space of sections of a bundle of injective Langevins. So we can define the space like this. So it's the space of injective Langevins. Space of injective Langevins. So this space consists of triples. So you need to have X, Y, and alpha, where X is a point in M, Y point in N, and alpha is an injective map of tangent spaces. Right. So this is the space of injective Langevins, and notice that this space is a fiber bundle over M times N. Right, so it's fibers over M times N, and the fiber is equivalent to the space of injective maps of Rm to Rn. So actually, it's equivalent to the Stifel manifold, Vmn. And then we can also project to M. And so the space of monomorphism is really equivalent to the space of sections of this fiber bundle. So if we denote this by, so if we denote this composition by P, so then we get that space of formal immersions from U to N is exactly the same. It's not equivalent, it's exactly the same as the space of sections over U of this fiber bundle M. And So, and we will see later, so what it means, you know, to be linear functor. So I'll give definition of a linear functor. And you will see why this definition is important. Good. So next, let me okay, so next I want to give example of polynomial functors. So what are example of polynomial functors? So like covariant case. So for example, we have a functor u which assigns to any open set u, u squared, right? Or it assigns to u, so this functor is going to be quadratic. Assigns to u the configuration space of two points in u. Or a functor which assigns to u the non-ordered configuration space. U choose two, it's notation of Michael Weiss. So u choose two. So this is non-ordered configurations. So, and all these are examples of quadratic functors. So they are all quadratic and covariant. And of course we can, instead of u to the two, we can take the u to the power k functor. Or we can, if you have a fiber bundle over m choose k, right? So we can just assign to u the preimage of u choose k. Right, so this is also going to be a functor which is a polynomial of degree k, right? So notice that it can also be written as a some kind of u choose case with a twisted coefficient f, where f is a fiber of this map. So now, what about contravariant examples of polynomial functors? So contravariant examples. Polynomial functors. So again, I haven't given definition yet, so I really talk about examples. And so we can consider maps from u to the power k to any space A. Right, so this is going to be a functor of degree k. So degree k. Or we can take a space of maps, equivariant map from configuration of configuration space of k points in U to some space B, where B has sigma k action. So this is also degree k functor. For example, we can take, like as a particular example, we can take the space of maps from sigma k equivariant maps from k points in U to k points in any given manifold N. So, and actually, this functor is a polynomial of degree k, and it is related to the embedding functor. So I will explain in which sense. Or if you have a fiber bundle, as before, over m choose k. So what we can do, we can define a functor which assigns to u the space of sections over u choose k. So all these are examples of polynomial functors of degree k. So maybe I want to give one more definition. One more example. So consider the functor, covariant functor u goes to u to the power k. I just want to describe how its Taylor tower looks like. So Taylor tower for this functor f. So thing is that even so it looks like f of x equal to x to the power k, so you would think that like in the usual case when we have a function x to the power k, so it's a degree k minus 1 approximation is trivial. Actually, in this case, it is not trivial. So it is not a so-called homogeneous factor. So because its linear approximation, quadratic, etc., up to degree k minus 1 approximations are not trivial at all. So, and actually, TIF of U can be described as a subspace in U to the power k. So consisting of points like this, such that the cardinal of this set x1, xk is at most I. Right. So that's how this functor looks like. So for example, T0 f of u is going to be the empty space. Right. So it's a constant empty functor. T0 of f is a constant empty functor. T1 f of u consists of all, it's a small diagonal. So we have all the guys like this. So x in, is in u, right? So you see it's equivalent to u. So it's equivalent to the linear functor u. And if you take tk minus 1, f of u, it's actually the fed diagonal. So it's a fed diagonal. So delta k u inside u to the k. Right, so it's a complement to the configuration space of k points in u. And tk f is equal to tk plus 1 f, etc. t infinity f, and it is equal to just your functor f. So you see this functor is polynomial of degree k. It means that starting from degree k, all the approximations are going to be the same as your functor f. So just want to see your faces. Guys, so is it clear, these examples? It's clear. Okay, very good. So these were just examples of polynomial functors. And now I want to go with definition. So now we want to discuss the definition of so what is a linear functor, what is degree k functor. And let me actually I want to give just one more example. So consider covariant functor u which assigns to u the cone space of u. Cone of u. So if you have just any space u, so a cone is a space which looks like this, right? So you know it's a standard construction, and you see that C of u is contractible. Right, for any space, including even empty space. For the empty space, C of empty space is just a point. Right, but it's always contractible. And so this functor actually has degree zero. So this functor is degree zero functor. Degree zero functor. So you see it's not constant, it is homotopy constant. So homotopically constant. It is homotopy constant. Right, so any restriction map is a weak homotopy equivalence. Right, so if you have u to v, then f of u, so c of u next to c of v is always a homotopy equivalence, and therefore this is just a homotopy constant functors. so now I give definition. So definition of a linear covariant functor. So definition. A covariant functor f from O of M to top is linear. So linear or of degree one. So if for any pair of open sets of M, the square f of u, sorry, f of u intersection v, f of u, sorry, actually this map doesn't have to be an inclusion, just any map. I mean, this is just restriction map. So So f of v, f of u union v is homotopy co-Cartesian. So if any square, if is homotopy co-Cartesian. So what it means, homotopy co-Cartesian? So first of all, co-Cartesian means that we have a push-out diagram. So just co-Cartesian means that f of u union v is just f of u union with f of v along f of u intersection v. And homotopy co-Cartesian means, or in other words, we have f of u union v is the same as just the collimit of the diagram f of u intersection v, f of v, right? So we have just an equivalent. So this would mean co-Cartesian square. And homotopy co-Cartesian means topy co-Cartesian. So it means very similar things. This would mean that f of u union v is equivalent. So it's not equal, it's just equivalent to the homotopy collimit of the same diagram. F of u, f of u intersection v, f of v. And quite often, actually, collimit coincide with a homotopy collimit. Not always, but quite often. Let me say often or sometimes. Often we have that collimit coincide with the homotopy collimit. But in general situation, to compute this homotopy collimit, what you need to do, you need to take a cylinder over f of u intersection v. So you multiply this guy by segment by the interval 0, 1, and then you attach the cylinder to, you know, to f of u and also f of v, you know, just as the usual cylinder map, f of v. So just want to see people. So guys, is it clear, like this topological description of the collimit? Is it clear?
Only one question. Mm-hmm. What does it mean that they are equivalent? They are weak homotopy equivalent, or
right? We mean weak homotopy equivalent. Yeah, weak homotopy. So you know, weak homotopy equivalent means that they have the same set of pass connected components, and the homotopy groups of the corresponding components are the same, right? So we are working in the model category of topological spaces, you know, where cofibrant objects are the generalized CW complexes.
Right. Okay. So, they must be induced by some maps.
Yes. Right. Yes, it should be some map. Right. So it should be induced by some map. Right. At that. And right. And so this is just the case, you know, when we want to construct, understand the homotopy collimit. You know, it's not always true that. So the thing is that we want this collimit to be homotopy invariant. And so which means that no matter if you have some other diagram, so you have a diagram like this and a diagram like this, and you have a natural transformation of diagram, so which means that you have a map like a morphism between diagrams such that every square commutes. And homotopy invariant collimit, it means that when you take the homotopy collimit of the one diagram and you take homotopy collimit of the other diagram, the induced map is going to be in equivalence. Right. If you just take a collimit, it will not be true. So it's not always true that the collimit induces you equivalence. But homotopy collimit always induces you an equivalence. So that's why we often call it like homotopy invariant collimit. So, okay, so now let me Okay, so maybe just one example. So example, consider the functor u goes to u squared. So let us check that it is not linear. So it is not linear. So in this case, the colimit coincides with the homotopy colimit. And so when we consider like when we apply it to the square, right, it's not the same as u squared union is over u intersection v squared with v squared, right? It's quite easy to see that if you take, so assume that the u is, you know, this part. So this is u, and this part is v, right? So then we get that, right? So we get a similar picture here. Right? So this is u, and then we have a similar picture for v. Right? So we get like this, right? And so you see that like this part, so the right hand side part is going to be union of u squared and v squared, right? And you see that we don't get the u union v squared, right? So you see that it's not kind of linear, it doesn't have this property, right? So but if you consider but if you consider the functors u goes to like preimage of u, where p is a fiber bundle over m, so it's quite easy to see that actually we are going to get you know, this linear property. So it's linear. So in the sense that preimage of u union v is going to be preimage of u union with preimage of v, right? And union over preimage of u intersection v. That was about the definition for the linear covariant functor. So we have a similar definition in contravariant case. So definition, a contravariant functor f from O of M to top is linear if for every pair of open sets in M, actually I should say like O of M, right? So we have the square, so similar square that we just invert the arrows, right? So we get F of U union V, F of U F of V, F of U intersection V, and this square must be homotopy Cartesian. Is homotopy Cartesian. Homotopy Cartesian, and homotopy Cartesian means that, meaning that F of U union V can be computed from as a homotopy limit. Homotopy limit of the diagram f of u, f of u intersection v, f of v. Right? So, so essentially what we just, we consider the square and we take the, like the everything without f of u union v. So somehow this property is nice because you can extrapolate. So if you know your functor on a simpler looking pieces of your manifold, you can kind of extrapolate it to more complicated objects. And there is some linear property, like you can extrapolate it, you know, on more complicated open sets from, you know, knowing it how it looks like on smaller sets. In the same way as Meyer-Veritoris sequence can help you to compute the homology of any manifold. So what is, just to kind of say you that the limit, usual limit of this diagram intersection V f of V is just the so-called the fibered product. So we take the product of f of U with f of V, but we take product over their intersection, f of U intersection V, right? So you might have seen, right, so when we have a diagram of the form f of U, right, f of U intersection V. So I don't know, I think this is clear. I think this is clear. And so how we understand the homotopy limit? So homotopy limit actually looks like a space of triples. So of the same diagram, U, f of U intersection V, f of V. So it looks like a space of triples. So x0, x1, and y, where x0 is a point in f of u, x1 is a point in f of v, and y is a path in the space f of u intersection v, right? So somehow it's dual construction of this, you know, cylinder, right, when we take the limit. So now, so what we have, you know, f of u space, so we choose a point x in it. So then we have also the space f of v, right? We also choose a point, so like this is x0, this is x1. And in the middle space, we choose a path, u intersection v. So we choose a path which actually connects. So actually it's not any path, it should respect the inclusion. So this should be, should come from the point x0. So if you denote this by I and this by j, so this should be I of x0, and this should be j of x1. Right. So this is a space of triples. Okay. So that's an example. So this is definition of the linear functor. And since really we want to understand the space of embeddings, so since we study space of embeddings, which is so we really want to study the functor m n is contravariant, right? So therefore we really want to study contravariant functors. Because of this, now I will only give definition of a polynomial contravariant functor of degree k. So definition, a contravariant functor from O of M to top. What happened? M to top. So is polynomial of degree less than or equal to k if for any collection of, so for any, well, first of all, open set, for any open U, U in of M, and also for any collection of K plus one closed disjoint joint subsets in M. So one has, so the cube which assigns to any subset S the set F of U minus union I and S f of it's not actually it's not union, it's intersection. So if we take intersection, I'm wrong, sorry, of course it's union, sorry guys, union of this guy's AI, right? So this is a cube. And so let me draw this cube in the case when case two. So I'll just draw the cube on case two. So we have f of u, right? Then we have f of u minus a zero. So we also have f of u minus a one. So we also have f of u minus a two, right? And we take the other guys, right? F of u minus a zero union a one. So here we are also going to have a cube. So f of u minus a1 union a2, right? And so then we have here f of u minus a0 union a2, right? And finally, the very last guy is going to be f of u minus a0 union a1 union a2. So this is an example of a cube, you know, when case two. Right, and more generally, it's just the factor which assigns any subset of the set 0, 1, k, this space, f of u minuses. So what it means, and I didn't finish the phrase, so the cube is homotopy Cartesian. So is, make it a little bit smaller so that it fits. So what's going on? I'm a little bit lost. So what's going on? So we have that this cube is homotopy Cartesian. So is homotopy Cartesian. So homotopy Cartesian means that f of u is homotopy limit of the rest. So this means that f of u is equivalent, like we have natural map, right, from f of u to the homotopy limit of the rest of the cube. So on the rest of the cube is going to look like this. So we have f of u minus a zero. So we also have f of u minus a1, we have f of u minus a2. So so the rest of the cube is going to look as a barycentric subdivision of a simplex. Like in this case, it's going to be barycentric subdivision of a triangle. F of u minus a0 union a1. Right, so here we are going to have f of u minus a1 union a2. And so here we are going to have f of u minus a0 union a2. And finally, we are going to have the center of this triangle f of u minus a0 a1 a2. Right. And so f of u must be equivalent to the homotopy limit of this diagram. And just to describe this diagram, so what it means, homotopy limit. So this space can be described as a space of 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 tuples. So this space is really the space of x0, x1, x2, y0, 1, y0, 2, y1, 2, and z0, 1, 2. So where xi lives in f of u minus ai, so yij lives in a, so it's actually a path. So it's a path in f of u minus ai union aj, right? And zij is going to be a map from, so 0, 0, 1, 2 is a map from a triangle to the space which is you know, in the center, so to the, you know, this space f of u minus a zero union a one union a two. Okay, and but of course we need to have this consistency property, right? So when we choose a so like before in the homotopy limit, right? So when we choose a right, so we have a point here, point here, point here. So then we are going to have a path, you know, in the space here, space here, and space here. And so this path it must be compatible, right? So you remember when you choose a path, somehow this point must come as image of this point, and the other endpoints of the path should come as image of this point. So similarly, we are going to have here and here, right? So this point comes as image of this one, and this point is image of this one. And also in the middle space, right, so we are going to have a map of triangle, right, and so this triangle should also, like, so what we have on the boundary of this triangle is determined by the passes which we have in these spaces, right. So just want to see your faces to make sure that you understand what I mean. So guys, is it clear what I mean? It's clear. Okay, very good. All right, so so this that's an explanation of what we mean by homotopy limit, and you know this map must be an equivalence, right? So must be an equivalence, and smaller. Right. So that was definition of a polynomial factor of degree k. So this is a definition of polynomial factor of degree k. And of course, we really want to apply this to the space of embeddings. And so the question is, how we can describe the degree k polynomial approximation of the space of embeddings. So, what we have a map from, so we have natural transformation from the this embedding factor to the case polynomial approximation. Right. So how we can describe this factor? So how we can describe it? Can describe it. So I should immediately say that actually the linear approximation, so linear approximation is the same as the space of immersions. Space of immersions, so it's equivalent to the space of immersions, provided the dimension of M is less than N. But in general case, actually, it's equivalent to the space of formal immersions. So here is always, we have this equivalence, right? So this is always. And this is only provided M is less than N. And essentially, we have this equivalence also provided M is less than N. Right. Okay, so let me give you there is there is a very nice natural transformation. So we have a natural transformation from, you know, this factor to the factor which assigns maybe indeed I'll write okay, so we can take the space of sigma k equivariant maps, map sigma k. And here you take your u to the power k to n to the power k, right? Or even better, we can take the actually it's even better to take the instead of m to the power k, we can take the configuration space of k points in m. So we can take k points in this open set U to k points in n. To n. Right. So there are natural transformations like this. So these are degree k polynomial approximations. So they are not polynomial approximations, but these are just degree k maps. And we know that this map should factor through the polynomial approximation of degree k. And actually, there exists. So we can take them all together. So we can take these approximations up to k points. So actually, it's natural to take, you know, approximations when we assign. So we have natural map from this guy to the product I less than equals than k, and then we take the sigma I equivariant maps from I points in M to I points in N. And right hand side really look somewhat similar to the case of polynomial approximation. So essentially, to define the case polynomial approximation, it's not enough to look at exactly k configuration, k points in M. We really need to look at the all possible configuration points in M and N. But also we need to, so it's not polynomial approximation because we still need to take into account the tangential data. So we need to take into account tangential data. And another thing is that we really, so it's not going to be just the product of the spaces. We really need to take into account that points can collide. So if you have a bunch of points in M, so they collide, so we get configuration with less number of points. And somehow this sequence of maps should respect this collision. So the sequences of maps, so F1, F2, FK, right, where so this sequence of maps, so they must respect collisions of points. Right, so it's not good approximation yet because somehow we need to take into account this, you know, so what happens when points and configurations collide. Okay, so I think it's a good moment to, you know, to have a break. Because starting from now, I want to speak about, you know, how the little this operator appears, you know, in this picture. So any questions?
Yeah, I have a question.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. In the, just a little bit above, when you had the T1 of embeddings is equivalent to embeddings, what is F?
Just a second. Your F is embedding factors. You see, the thing is that this space of embeddings can be viewed as a factor, right? So it's a factor from, right? So you assign to any open set U, you assign embeddings of U to N, right? So
yes.
which means that your F is really this embedding factor.
Oh, no, I didn't mean a big F. I meant the little F by immersions. Just
Okay. So M is the dimension of M,
uh-huh.
And N is the dimension of the M, of the ambient space. Mm-hmm. So this I should have said it. I'm very sorry. I was a little bit sloppy.
And not that. What's little F in front of
a little F? I defined the space of formal immersions. So you remember when I was talking?
F stands for formal.
Yeah, formal immersion. Remember, I was talking about. So what is formal immersion? And they can be seen as a space of sections. You remember?
Yeah. Okay.
So you want me to show this in the slides, or you remember?
No, I think I'm good. Yeah.
Okay, good. This is formal immersions, right? So it's essentially a little bit more data than saying it's a little bit more than mapping space from M to N, right? So you see that here from linear part, so from one configuration, from configurations with just one point, right? So we have just, you know, mapping from M to N. But we can incorporate this tangential data in this, you know, by saying that the first space is actually this space of formal immersions, or the space of sections of the of this jet bundle over M, so of injective van jets, right? So this would be a way to incorporate the tangential data. But thank also, okay, so good.
Can I ask just a curiosity?
Okay, please.
But these factors we look at, like polynomial factors, must respect some property with respect to nested unions, which is like for union with the intersection is okay.
Yeah, actually it's a very good question. I was a little bit sloppy on this. So usually one considers so-called first of all homotopy invariant factors. So if you have isotopy invariant, so if you have so there was one technical thing which I lied to you. So namely, not lied, but I just didn't say. So we always consider functors such that they are isotopy invariants. So if some inclusion, so inclusion of U to V is an isotopy equivalence, so which means that so is an isotopy equivalence. Okay. So isotopy equivalence means that you can have an embedding which goes the other way around, such that the compositions are isotopic to identity maps.
Okay, perfect.
Right. So in this case, the restriction map going this way in covariant case, or you know, in contravariant case, goes like this. So the restriction maps must be a homotopy equivalence.
Okay,
so
perfect.
This is good factor. So let me say this is good factor. So I didn't say, but we need to if we consider good factor. So there is this property. And another property, exactly what you said. So when we have a sequence of open sets, n, etc., so then we want to say that f of f of union of all this ui is equivalent to the homotopical limit or homotopy limit. Co limit of f of ui.
Okay, thank you.
Yep.
Because I was thinking like in non-compact case, maybe we need a lot of small opens or something like that. But if you can like use unions like this, yeah, okay. Thank you.
Okay. Okay, so any more questions or we go for a break?
Maybe I have a question very quickly. I don't understand very well how the natural transformation between the embedding functor and the equivariant maps is defined. One of the last thing you wrote.
Right, so it's really evaluation map, right? So we have a, so what I'm saying is that given an embedding, so we have natural map from, you know, this space to the space of equivariant maps of configuration of K points in U to configuration of K points in N, right? It's really evaluation. So when we have a given an embedding here, so what we can do, we can assign this equivariant maps which sends x1 xk to just f of x1 f of xk. So it's just evaluation map. So this is really evaluation, it should be called evaluation map.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah, but important is that this is a map, so the target is a polynomial factor of degree k, right? And so, and we are going to construct the case polynomial approximations, combining together, you know, all these evaluation functors.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, so